Hello and welcome back to Functional Analysis. And as always, I want to thank all the nice people that support this channel on Steady or PayPal. Today we have part 7 where we discuss examples of Banach spaces. Please recall the picture from the last time where we learned that a Banach space is on the one hand a real or complex vector space and on the other hand a complete metric space, where the connection is given by the norm. Of course, now we can find a lot of examples. Let's start with the simplest one. You can just consider the real number line. Therefore, we already know it's a one-dimensional real vector space. And we also know that we can calculate lengths if we consider the absolute value in the real numbers. Indeed, with our definition, this is a norm. And then you should know the associated metric is given by this formula. And that's just the normal metric we have in the real numbers. And now from real analysis, you should know that all the Cauchy sequences indeed converge in R. In other words, R together with this norm is a Banach space. So this is our first, and as you can see, a very simple example. However, we can consider even a simpler example. And you might already guess, instead of a one-dimensional vector space, we choose a zero-dimensional vector space. This means that the zero vector is the only vector in the space. And of course, there's only one norm we can define here, because the zero vector has to have length zero. Hence, everything we need here is fulfilled, we have a Banach space. Of course, this is a very boring one and not very helpful. Indeed, often it's a pathological one, which means that some theorems we will prove later for Banach spaces will not hold for this particular one here. Please keep that in mind if you want to use the zero Banach space as your example. However, now let's continue with one of the most important examples. This is the LP space written as LPNF. N denotes the natural numbers and F is our field, so the real or complex numbers. NP is a real number greater or equal than 1, but it could also be infinity. However, infinity is a special case we consider later, so here I exclude it. Now, as I said, this LPNF is defined as all the sequences in F that fulfill one condition. So you immediately see the notation here makes sense. This is the domain and this is the codomain for the map given by the sequence. And now this condition is given by the series where you add up all the sequence members and we do it in the absolute value n to the power p. And if this series now converges, which means it's less than infinity, then the sequence is an LP. Often from the context it's clear if we are dealing with real or complex numbers and what the index set of the sequences is, and therefore one just writes LP in this case. Now the first thing you should note is that if we ignore this condition and just consider the sequences, then they form a vector space. Because adding and scaling is just given in a component-wise sense. Therefore, here we just have to show that LP is a subspace of this bigger vector space. However, what we also want is a norm for this vector space. And usually one just uses a P as an index. Now, if we give the whole sequence the name X, then we can calculate the P norm of X by using this number, because we know it's finite. However, you might already see that the second property of a norm is not fulfilled in this case. We also need the pth root outside. If you set p equals to 2, you will recognize something similar to the Euclidean norm in Rd. Indeed, with similar arguments, we can show that this now gives us a norm. I emphasize that this is not trivial to show that, and indeed I skipped that here, but we will do it later. Here in this video, I want to focus how we get the completeness of the space. Hence, our claim is LP together with this norm is a Banach space. The first part of the proof has to be that LP is an F vector space and that this P norm is indeed a norm on it. I already told you, we don't do it here, we assume it, we will prove it later. That's just because we need a lot of technical details for this and I think it will distract us from the important completeness part of the proof here. Now, in order to show the completeness, we have to choose an arbitrary Cauchy sequence. So this might be hard to understand now. The queen x is a sequence in F, and now we have to consider sequences of sequences. Therefore, I choose here an upper index k to denote the different sequences we have in our Cauchy sequence. And now we have to show that all the sequences here in a row converge to another sequence, a limit. Okay, to get the right idea, let's write down some of the sequences. So here you see our Cauchy sequence, which goes from top to bottom. Now, for example, our x1 is a sequence in LP, so it consists of real or complex numbers in a row. And the same we can write down for x2, x3, and so on. Now, if you look at this picture, you see a lot of numbers in F in two different directions, from left to right and from top to bottom. And please keep in mind, in the end, we want the limit here on the left. In order to find this, we can just look at the different sequences we have here from top to bottom. So maybe we just take the fourth column here, and then we look at the difference between two members of this sequence. So maybe we use k and l for the corresponding index. Now we want to put in the information we already have, which means we consider here the absolute value to the power of p. And then we know this is less or equal than summing up all other possibilities. That just means that we have here all the other columns as well. Of course, we do that because here we have our p norm to the power p. And there we find our original sequences again, where we know that they form a Cauchy sequence. Don't worry, I remind you what it means to be a Cauchy sequence here. For all epsilon greater 0, we find an index, and maybe we call it capital K, such that for all indices afterwards, K and L, we have that the distance between two members here is less than epsilon. Now, if you look at the inequality above, you see that this thing here is always greater than just looking at the absolute value in one column. Let's put that in here, and then you can see this sequence here of normal numbers in F, so this column here, is also a Cauchy sequence in F. The absolute value is just the normal norm in F, so the real numbers or the complex numbers. And we already discussed this in the first example, this is a Banach space. In other words, this sequence has a limit. And a suitable name should be x tilde with an index 4. And this limit in F is what we find if we go from top to bottom in the fourth column. Of course, the 4 was just an example. You can do all the things here with another column as well, so we can introduce an index m, for example. And then I can change it here everywhere. Now, this means for all the columns here, we find the corresponding limit, x tilde m, we have here at the bottom. So indeed, what we get here on the right is a new sequence with numbers in F. Of course, we can and we should give it the name x tilde, but we don't know yet if it's the limit here on the left. This is what we still have to show now. Okay, so the plan is to show that xk minus x tilde in the p norm goes to 0. Or in other words, for an arbitrary epsilon, this should be smaller than epsilon. Okay, so then let's write down the p norm again. So we have this series and we need the p root again, but it's easier to write power of p on the other side. This just means that we use the p root just in the end. The first idea now would be to push the limit process here outside. So we write the limit of n to infinity. So you see, it's completely the same, but now we can discuss this finite sum here on the right. However, we know that this x tilde n is also a limit. Hence, we can push that limit out as well, because the absolute value is a continuous function and we just have a finite sum here. Now, if you look back, you will see that this thing here is what we can keep as small as we want. We use again that we have here the property of the Cauchy sequence. Therefore, for our given epsilon, we choose our capital K such that we have this. At this point in the proof, we can't know how small this really should be. Therefore, to be careful, maybe we introduce an epsilon prime and define it later on. Now, what we know from above is that this whole thing is less than epsilon prime to the power p. As long as k and l are bigger than the capital K. It's the same reasoning as here. Okay, so this is good information for us because it tells you we have here the non-negative numbers that are bounded from above by this constant. Of course, then comes some limit process, but we know in the worst case, this limit is exactly this upper bound. So in summary, we know for all k greater or capital K, this whole thing is less or equal than epsilon prime to the power p. And now is the point to take the p's root because we get rid of these two p's. And now to get to the correct result, we need epsilon prime to be less than epsilon itself, which means we can define epsilon prime, for example, as epsilon half. And now in the end, you can put everything together. For an arbitrarily chosen epsilon greater 0, you find a capital K, such that for all indices after the capital K, you find the inequality here, the distance between xk minus x tilde is less than epsilon. And there we have it, x tilde is indeed the limit of xk with respect to the p norm. The only thing missing is the explanation why x tilde is also an element in Lp. However, this now follows from all we know. We know here that the difference is in Lp, and we also know that xk is in Lp. Therefore, if you write x tilde in this way, which means you subtract xk and add it again, then you see the linear combination. Which means here is one part in Lp, and here is one part in Lp. Hence, also the sum is in Lp, because we are dealing with a vector space. That's the part of the proof at the beginning where we skip the details, but here we can use it. Of course, we will discuss this even further in upcoming videos, but at this point, I really wanted to show you an important and non-trivial example of a Banach space. Okay, I hope I see you in the next videos, where I first explain more concepts in functional analysis, and afterwards we go into more details for examples. So, thanks for listening and see you later. Bye!